Oh. Hello, this is Mr. Purcell, and today we're going to be working the review for the Math 13-14 final exam. And so, problem number one is simplifying a complex number. We have a square root of a negative number, and so to simplify this fraction, what we'll do is start off by simplifying this square root. Do you remember how to do that? 50 is not a perfect square.
No.
Okay, so what's the biggest perfect square that divides into it? 25? Now, since there's a negative number under the square root, that means we're going to have an I. Okay? So I'm just going to think of it as negative 25 times, is it a 2?
Mm-hmm. And that green thing at the end is starting to go.
Oh, well, I'll stop using it.
Yeah.
So, okay, so 5i, the square root of negative 25 is 5i, and then that square root of 2. So I'll rewrite it, replacing the square root with 5i square root of 2. So we have a negative 20 plus, I think I'll just write all of this here in red, 5i square root of 2 all over 60 with imaginary numbers. To simplify this, y'all remember you had to separate it.
Yes.
Put each one of these over 60. And then reduce each fraction individually. Like the negative 20 over 60, what could that reduce to?
By divide.
Yeah, so we have negative 1/3, divide above and below by 20 there. Then plus, how can I cancel here?
Okay. 5 will go into 60.
Twelve times.
Hey, can we cancel a 2?
1/12?
Can we cancel that 2 with the 2 down here?
I think I'll just try.
No, because the 2 is not underneath. I mean, the 12 is not under a square root, so you can't cancel.
This blue is sort of going.
Good thing it's semester.
Yeah.
Any questions there?
Oops. So now you get to type all of that in, Tim.
Wait. Did you get it written down? Yes, okay. So we have a negative 1/3. Get out of the denominator before we put our plus. And then it's a fraction. We have I, square roots of 2 on top. Click down in the bottom and type 12. Any questions there? Number 2. We're multiplying complex numbers. I remember saying that multiplying complex numbers is very similar to just algebraic multiplication. If those i's were x's, what would you do to multiply those things? FOIL them out, I agree.
And there's one other rule you're going to have to use, but rather than just FOIL, something about I squared. Do y'all remember that?
-1, that's correct.
I is the square root of -1, so I squared would just be -1. So we FOIL first. So we have a 10 minus 20i, I agree. And then
wait.
Oh, 10.
I forgot to switch. So 10 minus 20i.
Plus 12i.
Minus
24i
squared.
Okay. You're replacing this I squared with a negative 1, so negative 24 times negative 1 would just be a plus. Okay. So this I squared I marked out, and the 24 became positive. Now, can we combine our like terms? See, what can I combine with the 10? Yeah, 10 plus 24 is 34.
Why did we cancel the I squared? I'm sorry.
Okay. I squared is negative 1. It comes from the fact that I is the square root of negative 1. So if we just square both sides here, we have I squared equals, when you square a square root, what happens to that? Cancels out.
Right.
So, what happened right over here? I replaced the I squared with negative 1. So, we have a blue negative 24 times a red negative 1. Negative 24 times negative 1 is positive 24. So, like Jennifer said when I was writing it out, she said, mark out the I squared and change the sign on the 24.
Automatically.
Mm-hmm.
Or you'll forget. I just totally forgot about that.
It's been a while since you've done this, probably.
Now, this is multiplying complex numbers isn't something that we do over and over in the class.
Negative 20, is that going to be a minus? Can I subtract the 34 minus 8? Say no. So it's just 34 minus 8i.
Any questions? What about the peanut gallery? Any questions? No? Okay. So 34 minus 8i.
We should probably sit over there if you go too loud.
You're
not too loud.
Well, they said that we talked
too much. We did not say you talked too much. We most certainly did not.
I remember that maybe 3 or 4 weeks ago.
I most certainly never said that. I never said that you talked
too
much.
Not y'all.
Oh.
You said the peanut gallery okay, and they said, oh, we sit over here because
I think
like
that was just joking.
Yeah, okay.
They were joking. Oh, gosh.
I try to be smart now.
Solve the quadratic equation using the quadratic formula. So
there's only one correct first step here. Yeah, we got to get it in that standard form. Ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0. So we need to subtract the 7. So 10x squared, am I showing up there? Okay. Plus 6. X minus 7.
You can try to factor it, but it's not factorable.
It says use the quadratic formula.
What
I've learned is
if the instructions specifically say use the quadratic formula, then it's not factorable. If you can factor it, then great, do it. But generally, what I've learned is if the instructions say use the quadratic formula, it's not going to be factorable.
Yeah, if it was x squared, but now that I see it's 10. Okay, so then you use that a
plus square root.
Negative b plus minus square root.
Just minus
b squared.
B squared minus 4
ac.
Over
2a. Uh-huh. And so I hope y'all can tell my b from my 6. I guess it's a convenient thing that the b and 6.
B and 6 are the same thing.
It's better than c being a 6, because then it might look like c equals b. What the heck am I saying? Okay, so plugging in here, in place of the b, I'm going to put that black 6. So we have a negative 6.
Plus or minus the square root of 36.
Negative 6. Plus or minus the square root of b squared. I agree with 36. If you can get something that you can just do in your head, by all means, do it. Don't show that step. 6 squared is 36.
And then a b minus 4, 3c is 10, and negative 7.
Minus 4 times A times C all over 2 times A. I'm going to go ahead and just do that in my head. It would be 20.
I think we've gotten it up.
So,
unless we're actually taking the test and then screw it all.
Let's try to simplify in here.
Negative 6 plus minus square root of 316?
Let's see, we have the 36. And then negative 4 times 10 times negative 7. Is that a positive 280? It'd be 40 times 7. So I'm thinking it's a positive 280. So I'm agreeing with you. 316? Is that what you said, Caitlin? Square root of 316? Oh, gosh. Can we reduce that? There's a perfect square root.
I don't think so.
Look
I
at that.
I think we can.
Right off.
Oh, the square root of 316.
Square root of 316. We can think of 16 as 4.
4.
Times 79. And I just got lucky. I just thought, what's the first even perfect?
Could you do a bigger one than that or
no? I don't think so, because 79 isn't that prime.
Prime. Mm-hmm.
And so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So how will I simplify the square root of 316? It's 2 square root 79. See what I just did? Simplifying that square root of 16 is 2 square root of 79. I'm now going to replace this mess, my circled square root, with 2 square root of 79. So I have negative 6. It's going to be a plus minus answer.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So there'll be 2. Usually when you're doing the quadratic formula, there are 2 separate. Now,
when there's an I, look back at number 1. If you have a fraction with an I on top and an integer on the bottom, notice how we separate it to get it in the form A plus or minus BI. But when there isn't
an I,
the general, the preferred method of reduction is factoring. Look at the 3 numbers outside of the radical. 2, 6, and 20. Yeah. What's the biggest number that divides evenly into 2, 6, and 20?
And here's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to make a note. I'm dividing above and below by 2. All 3 of the numbers that are not under the square root symbol is what I'm dividing. Negative 6 divided by 2. Negative 3. 2 divided by 2 would just be a 1, which I don't need to write. And what about in the bottom? 20 divided by 2, 10. Negative 3 plus minus the square root of 79 all over 10.
If you use the quadratic formula and your final answer has a square root in it, that's saying you could not have factored. Think about when you factor. You don't pick up square roots when you're going through factoring. So the presence of that square root there says you could have sat there all day trying to factor this thing and you would not have been able to do it. So let's see.
Type it in.
Let me move this back down over here. So first thing I'm going to do is click the fraction hot button. And on top we have a negative 3 plus minus a square root of 79. And on the bottom we have a 10. Now, if you view an example on this problem, they may type it in as 2 separate cases. Negative 3 plus the square root of 79 over 10, comma, negative 3 minus the square root of 79 over 10.
You check that, and it would take both ways.
Yes, it does.
Yes.
That's what says use a comma to separate answers as needed. Prior to, 7 years ago or so, they introduced the plus minus.
I remember Tanya and I were both teaching college algebra classes at the same time when we discovered they, you know, and they had the little plus minus hot button. After all these years of having to type in the answers separately, they put a plus minus button. We've been telling
we were telling the Pearson Rip for years,
oh, y'all need to put a plus minus hot button. And they finally did, and oh, I was just so excited, which is sort of pathetic, I suppose. That something like that. Well, they sure took their time.
Yeah.
They took their time getting it, but.
I'm writing this one.
Oh, look at how he's printing this out. Mm-hmm. Look how he's writing the problem down.
I'm sort of spreading it out.
Why? Why is he spreading that problem out? Does that make sure you 2 to the 5 plus 4x squared over x minus 2?
Yeah, so. I think I did it. Why'd I spread it out like that?
What are we going to multiply through by?
To get rid of the fractions. You multiply through by that denominator, x minus 2. Make sure you're multiplying every term.
Each fraction is a term. This integer is a term also. Generally, terms are separated by equals and plus minuses that aren't part of a fraction. A fraction by itself is one term. So how many times is he going to have to write x minus 2? How many times is he going to multiply by x minus 2? Mm. Correct. Three times. So that first fraction just becomes
2x
equals
5x minus 10.
Yeah.
Okay, that's right. You distribute the 5 to get 5x minus 10 plus
4x squared.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
So we have a quadratic equation. How do I know it's a quadratic equation? Well, there's an x squared. So, yeah, I'd get 0 on one side. And whether you factor it or use the quadratic formula, that x squared term needs to be positive.
The coefficient of the x squared term needs to be positive.
So we're going to go to the right instead of left.
Right. I mean, correct.
Mm-hmm. But the x squared term will. Oops, wait, what did I do? I should be doing that. I'm subtracting 2x from both sides. So we have 0 on the left. But instead of just writing 3x minus 10 plus 4x squared, what do I have to write first?
0 equals 4x squared.
You've got to have the ax squared, the x squared term.
And then they have to be in order. Yeah.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0.
Let me see something. Did they say solve using the quadratic formula?
No.
No, so I bet this thing's factorable.
This will factor.
Mm-hmm. So 2x and 2x cannot possibly work.
Why can it not possibly work? Well,
if you use 2x and 2x, no matter which pair you use for 10, aren't you going to have 2 with an even number? You either have 2 with a 10 or 2 with a 5.
Mm-hmm.
Can you have a common factor inside parentheses?
No,
not if it's factored correctly. So we can discard that 2x and 2x. If you doubt me, try it. You're not going to be able to get back that plus 3x. So it's going to have to be 1x and 4x.
So x and 4x.
So.
Oh, we forgot to ask you what we know about the signs.
No.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to have one negative and one positive. The last sign's a minus, you have one of each.
That's
why we don't know where it goes. Yeah, right. We don't know
where it goes. You're right. I don't think that 10 can work. I think 10 is going I think I can see pretty quickly that 10 is not going to give us back that plus 3x.
5 and
2?
5 and 2?
Oh, you can't put a 2 here, but could we put it here?
Yeah, but it's going to give you a 2x.
if I put a 2 here and a 5 there, I'm not sure if I'm following what you're saying the problem is going to be. We would have an 8x and a 5x. Can we subtract those to get a 3x? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what's going to go in the first set of parentheses, a plus or a minus?
With the 2.
With the 2. Mm-hmm. I think it's going to be a plus. Because we want a positive 3x.
We put a plus here, that'd give us a positive 8. And a minus 5x. Are y'all agreeing with my factoring? Any questions?
Did we solve?
Uh-huh. Now set each one of these factors to 0. So x equals negative 2 and, yes, add the 5, divide by 4, so 5/4 and negative 2.
Wait, because we need to make sure that the fractions are defined.
Remember, you can't have a denominator of 0.
What number would have given us a denominator of 0? It should be obvious.
2.
Did you get a positive 2 as your answer?
No.
So both of those numbers are acceptable.
Mm-hmm. Well, type them.
They're still right.
Oh, okay.
What did you just say just now about positive 2 and negative 2? I'm sorry.
Remember how you can't have a denominator of 0?
And I remember that happening in the homework, and at least 2 or so of the problems where we got numbers that, when plugged back in, would give us a denominator of 0, and we'd call that an extraneous solution.
If that was x equals 2, then
we'd mark it out and adjust it 5 over 4.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to make sure.
So we're punching in, let's see, we had a negative 2, comma, 5 over 4.
Okay, we have time to do one more. Okay, it's a cut point problem. How do I know it's a cut point problem when it doesn't say anything about cut points?
That's the inequality. That's
if there's a less than or greater than.
It's
going
to be close.
And you're right about that too. Go ahead.
So x squared.
It's going to be close. Oh, I heard. It's going
to
be close.
Oh, closed.
Greater than or equal to x minus 4. Right. Well, there are no denominators. So we just have solution cut points here.
How do we find the solution cut points? We change the original problem somehow. Change it to equal, that's right.
So I'm going to need to... Now, this, to solve, find the solution cut points, this is a quadratic equation.
So you have to subtract the x.
Mm-hmm. Subtract the x and add the 4. So we have x squared, negative 4x minus x is negative 5x. And then negative 28 plus 4, is that a negative 24? Equals 0. This one's easier to factor than the other one because there's not a number in front of that x squared. So
it's easier.
It's a simple trinomial. When the leading coefficient is a 1, it's called a simple trinomial. And we know the signs, too.
Positive and negative.
I know a positive and negative. Yeah, I'd go ahead and write them down. I mean.
Okay.
And now.
Normally I wait, but I don't need to because it's going to be 1 times 24, 2 times 12, 3 times 8, or 4 times 6.
Hmm. It's a simple trinomial, so you choose the pair that adds or subtracts to give you that middle number. In this case, has to subtract.
So 8 and 3.
Mm-hmm. 8 and 3. Now think about it. What's going to go here? Are we going to put the 8 or the 3 to get a minus 5x?
X plus 3.
Correct.
Did I factor that right?
3x minus 8x gives us a negative 5x.
Mm-hmm. So we get x equals negative 3 and x equals 8. These are our solution cut points.
How are we going to label the solution cut points on a number line? Open or closed?
You've already answered it once. Closed. Okay, because of that equal sign on there, it'll be a closed circle. Let me draw a number line. Using this. Okay. Let's see. Negative.
I think it was Jennifer the last time we were doing one of these that wanted to. Oh, was it you, Mary May, that wanted to do the center? This time I think you're going to. I mean.
It's the zero, though.
Notice we didn't pick up repeated factors. So I'm 100% confident it's either going to be true, false, true, or false, true, false. We only have to check one interval.
Zero.
Okay, so you're going to test zero. Which interval contains zero? Interval one, two, or three?
Zero is always between a negative and a positive. It can't be between two negatives. It can't be between two positives. If there's one thing you got out of this class, hopefully, you can locate zero on the real number line. So if I test zero, I'm going to plug it in right up here in the black.
Can I just shoot out the answer?
0 squared minus, huh? Oh, you already know it? So we have negative 28 is greater than or equal to negative 4. Now, if those were both positive numbers, it'd be true. 28 is bigger than 4.
Negatively.
But since it's negative, I think.
Straight or cross out?
Shade.
No, cross out. It's not true.
Negative 28 isn't bigger than negative 4.
Cross shade.
Mm-hmm. You would rather have negative $4 in your checking account than negative 28, right? So that used to be a better example. Nowadays, I guess, is it possible to write hot checks anymore?
I don't think you can
anymore?
Write a hot check
but
anymore.
So the answer would be like the negative infinity, comma, negative three with the brackets.
Remember, you always use parentheses with negative infinities and positive infinities. You only use a bracket at closed dots.
And if there weren't an equal sign on the original problem,
if that had just said greater than, not greater than or equal to, it would have been open circles, all parentheses in your answer. Any questions there?
Well, go ahead and type it in, and that's what we'll call it here.
Really quick, number four, was the answer just a negative 2, comma, negative, or I'm sorry, negative 2, comma, 5, 4, or was there
anything that was
just
precise?
Just comma. No parentheses.
Those things that go like that.
They already had them there.
It already shows it. It already has it on there for you.
And then
okay,
I just
go back to number four.
See,
if you're just solving an equation.
So yeah, I did that. Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to make sure.
Then it has the little set braces, which we don't usually write. But they have them there for you.
Okay. Well,
it's about the
we'll
way you put
up.
It into that. I think I've got it, and then I messed it up by literally, like, the smallest little detail. So I'm going to put it in.
Okay.